Now Britt is late again. Ah, there she is. Britt, again you're late.
Sorry, sorry. There was too much traffic.
As always.
Okay.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
Hallo iedereen. Hi everyone. Bonjour tout le monde. Ik ben in mijn nopjes, want ik mag vandaag jullie reisgezelschap zijn. We gaan vandaag door de stad, net als morgen en overmorgen. We gaan de stad herontdekken door ontmoetingen, door toffe uitdagingen. En ook door... door vele nieuwe locaties te herontdekken. Door onze rolmodellen en queer artists. En de laatste dag gaan we ook nog allemaal performances zien in onze mooie hoofdstad. Nu, net zoals elke vakantie, vind ik het altijd tof om er goed uit te zien. Dus ik heb mijn nieuwste pakje aangedaan.
Very nice.
En ik wil graag dat mijn haar snit tip top in orde is. Dus I know just the place, hier net om de hoek. En hier zo vind je ook andere adressen waar je ook je haren lekker mooi kan doen. Kom maar mee, want we zijn al laat. Kom.
Let's go.
Hier heb je trouwens ook de club, de nachtclub Jealousy. Daar kan je enkel binnen met een wachtwoord. Of als je je charms gebruikt, lukt het misschien ook wel. Daar een beetje verder heb je La Brigitine. En hier is onze kapper. Ik ga mijn masker opzetten, of course. En we zijn klaar voor een coole haircut. Kom! Hallo Khadija!
Hey!
Hallo!
Ça va?
Bien? Toi?
Oké, super. Qu'est-ce que t'as envie?
La même chose, mais juste un peu le côté que ça vient. Don't do a close-up of the gray hairs.
They don't need to see that. Carine
is texting.
Are we
going to
meet her tonight?
Yes, possibly. Yes, later. Did you know she's not only the lady in charge of Velvet Ibiza and Velvet 69, but she also helps making tourism more accessible for everyone. She's a tourism expert, actually. And Khadija, quel est ton endroit favori à Bruxelles? Si tu veux aller manger quelque chose, faire un date avec quelqu'un.
Les adresses, c'est pas ça qui m'envoie. Tout dépend de ce qu'on a envie de manger en fait.
Ouais.
En cuisine italienne, j'aime beaucoup Fico. Ça, c'est la famille qui avait le Senza Nome. Senza Nome, c'est un restaurant avec une étoile ici au Sablon. Et ils ont ouvert un autre rue américaine, très très bon, super bon. De la vraie cuisine italienne. D'ailleurs, on s'est rencontrés la première fois.
Ah, celle-là?
Ouais, ouais. Ah. Ça, c'est un de mes restos préférés aussi.
Ah, je savais pas. Ouais, ouais. Voilà, ouais. Oh.
Merci beaucoup, Khadija.
We gaan nu naar de volgende ontmoeting. Ik heb er zin in. Oeh, met mijn nieuwe haircut. En ja, kom maar zijn weg, hè. Katrin, you know where we're going now?
No, but tell me.
So if you like the sound of skateboarding and you like to watch the cool kids, just let's have a quick stop over there and then we go to the next meeting.
Okay, sounds good.
Oh, they're texting. Cool. Let's go up here. Als jullie ook leuke vakantiefoto's hebben, stuur ons door naar matchbelgium@gmail.com of via Instagram. En dan misschien komen jullie ook in de show terecht. Totally one of the cool kids. Yeah. En daar heb je die kerk. Ik weet eigenlijk niet hoe die noemt.
Sablon. This is the Sablon Church, one of the two. Chapelle, la chapelle. That was good.
Hey!
Hey! Hoe is het?
Goed, goed, goed.
Long time no see.
Ja. Leuk je te ontmoeten.
Ja, Ida.
Op mijn favoriete plek in Brussel.
Ja, tof.
De galerijen. Koningsgalerij en Koninginnengalerij. Om eens door te wandelen.
Oké. Okay.
Het is een heel belangrijke plek. Er zijn een paar historische feitjes gebeurd. Maar ook heel belangrijk voor de LGBT. En ook een paar discotheken geweest in de jaren 80 en de jaren 90. En de eerste Velvet 5, Velvet 69 5, in 2010 heeft hier plaatsgevonden in Théâtre du Vaudeville.
Okay.
Maar we gaan eens doorwandelen.
Oké.
Okay. Okay. Dat is een van de mooiste overdekte galerijen in Europa, feitelijk. Het is heel gemakkelijk, het is vlak bij de grote markt. Normaal lopen er heel wat toeristen. Heel kalm, heel goed. Het is eigenlijk een combinatie van architectuur, cultuur en een beetje commerce. Dus begin jaren 80, denk ik, 82, 83. Was er hier in de galerij vooraan de fameuze club De Madame. Een van de eerste vrouwendiscotheken in Brussel. Niet de eerste, maar was vrij speciaal. Hè. Je moest dan door die dubbele deur, een gang door, moest je de lift nemen. Ik denk naar het tweede verdiep. Dan moest je terug aan een deur aanbellen. En dan kwam men door een luikje kijken of je wel een vrouw was. En dan mocht je binnen. Dan was je binnen en dan moest je een naam noteren in het gastenboek. Want dat was een privéclub.
Okay.
Een vrij speciaal.
En was de ingang duur?
Ik denk dat de ingang gratis was.
Ah, oké.
Okay. Je moet dat niet vergelijken met wat er nu bestaat. Nu hebben we enkele evenementen waar je een entree betaalt. In die tijd waren de discotheken twee of drie dagen per week open. En de meeste vroegen geen inkomen. Maar je moest dan wel consumeren. En dat ik me kan herinneren, ik vond dat toen vrij duur. Een pintje, dat kostte toen 100 Belgische frank. Equivalent van €2,50. Ik spreek over 82, 83. Ik vond het verschrikkelijk duur. Aan de andere kant van de galerij was ook een bekende club. Eind jaren 80. begin jaren 90 en in de Theater du Vaudeville. En dat was ook een privéclub. En op zondag waren er mannen vijven, nogal vrij berucht. Ik ben er zelf nooit naartoe geweest, maar iedereen kende de Vaudeville.
Ja. En dat was alleen maar op zondag?
Dat was op zondag voor de mannen, ja. Dus de galerij heeft wat te vertellen.
Ja, het lijkt me wel.
Ja.
Interessant.
Ik vroeg mij af, denk je dat de impact van corona is gigantisch op de evenementensector en de toeristische recreatiesector? Maar denk je dat het ook ergens een positieve impact zal hebben?
Er is altijd een positieve impact bij alles. Elke medaille heeft twee keerzijden. Heeft twee zijden. Ik denk dat de Belgen, dat ze hun eigen land terug ontdekken en dat ze nu toch een beetje verplicht zijn om op zoek te gaan naar leuke plekjes in Vlaanderen en in Brussel. En wat internationaal toerisme betreft, is het nu iets moeilijker. Maar ik denk dat we, als alles terug normaal is, dat de mensen toch meer gaan beseffen wat een luxe we hebben om te mogen reizen en te kunnen reizen. En dat we dan een keer gaan moeten bij stilstaan. En dat we dat ook gaan doen, van hoe waardevol dat is. Ik denk dat mensen anders mee omgaan met reizen.
Ja.
Ook misschien meer ecologisch verantwoord gaan reizen. Ik denk dat toch veel mensen heeft wakker geschud wat dat er nu gebeurd is. Dus op lange termijn heeft dat zeker een positieve invloed.
Gezien jij werkt als netwerkfacilitator voor Toerisme Vlaanderen, helpt eigenlijk mensen met een, als ik het juist heb begrepen, met een lagere inkomen.
Ja, we helpen de mensen met een beperkt budget om toch ook op vakantie te kunnen gaan. Dat kan een overnachting zijn, maar dat kan ook een daguitstap zijn in Vlaanderen. Ik werk voor Toerisme Vlaanderen.
Ja. Dus eigenlijk werk je aan inclusief toerisme, LGBT-minded, maar ook op een heel ander vlak.
Ja. Ja, inderdaad. Dat heb je goed gezien.
En Carine?
Ja, Brits.
ik vond het heel jammer dat Velvet Ibiza werd uitgesteld. Ik dacht, yes! Dit jaar kan ik eindelijk eens naar Ibiza.
Next year.
Next year. Want next year staat normaal gezien al vast. Hè?
Van 4 tot 9 mei.
4 tot 9 mei. De planning?
Met de welgekende ingrediënten. De top van de Europese vrouwelijke DJ's. Uiteraard een pak heel toffe activiteiten, wat speciale excursies erbij. En een internationaal publiek.
Oké.
En volgend jaar gaan we dubbel zo hard vieren.
Als je dat gehoord? Dubbel zo hard.
Ja. En als alles goed gaat, want de boekingen lopen al.
In Ibiza.
Ja, het was in Ibiza en ik vond het leuk.
Ja, ik ook.
En tot snel, hè.
Tot nog eens, hè.
Bedankt.
Bye bye.
Dag.
Ciao.
We are off to our next stop, which will be with Rachael Moore. She's meeting us at the Vertigo Bar. It's the place where we're coming from. So we will make a small tour here. Welcome to the Grand Place or the Grote Markt. And we will just walk to where we come from. You can follow. If you want to go to the gay neighborhood, follow me. This is it. Good. the hottest streets in town. And just over here, you have the Rainbow House, which is Rachael's workplace, actually. Hello, Rachael.
Hey, Brits.
How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm fine, too. I'm happy to see you during the corona times.
But we're keeping a distance.
Yes, definitely. I've been looking forward to meeting Rachael, who's the coordinator of Rainbow House Brussels and also co-founder of Rainbow Nation.
Yes, correct.
Rachael, I have a couple of questions for you.
Oh my god, nothing too difficult, I hope.
I hope not, but I'm sure you're an expert, so I can't wait to hear your answers.
Okay.
Maybe first tell me what's the effect of Corona on the Rainbow House, and maybe the LGBT community.
Mm-hmm. Let's start with the community because it's community first.
Yes.
So the effects of Corona on the LGBTQ community are not very positive. Because let's realize that we're already starting with a community that's already marginalized. So if your community is already marginalized to begin with when there's no pandemic, then it's not going to get any better during a pandemic. But we also know that the LGBTQI community knows how to deal with a pandemic. Yes, there's been a rise in violence. There's been a rise in LGBTQI phobic violence, also domestic violence. So things are not really positive for certain groups within the LGBTQI community. And this is also something that we're monitoring, that we're trying to actually find solutions for. Mm-hmm. But it is not always easy, knowing good and well that this corona time has affected the entirety of our society. So I think, you know, just pushing to working to find solutions together with other institutions like the city of Brussels and the region will possibly help us in order to make sure that these marginalized communities are better taken care of, especially during this particular period. So that's for the community. For the Rainbow House, it's pretty much the same thing. Financially, we're not doing so well. Of course, you know, closing from March up until now. I mean, our bar is open again.
And the bar. It's open again? I didn't even know.
The bar is open again and we have...
I need to pass by.
Yeah, you do. Everybody needs to come by because we need it. We need the support. So yeah, we have our bars open again, but it was closed from March up until now. And the month of May is actually the month where we make the most amount of money. And the money that we make from the bar is automatically reinvested into the house. It counts for a third of our financial year, or our finances, basically.
And so what she's saying, basically, go and drink a lot.
We're looking for actual solutions with the city of Brussels and with the region, hopefully with the mayor. So let's try and keep the house open. That's the goal.
That's the goal. Cool. Could you tell us, tell in your own words what the word intersectionality means?
Intersectionality. It's that beautiful buzzword that everybody's been using for the past 3 years. It sounds really good out loud because it's very long. It makes us sound really intelligent. But what does it actually mean? So intersectionality is basically a tool that we can use in order to look at different ways that someone is in their identity, different markers of their identity, and different oppressions that they may face due to their identity. So the easiest example that I can give is basically myself. I'm a living, breathing example of intersectionality. There is the aspect of race, I'm black. There is the aspect of class, I'm from a working class family. There is the aspect of gender, I'm a woman. So that in itself is already one aspect of intersectionality. And intersectionality, just basically, if you can imagine a road, an intersection, mm-hmm. where four roads come together, and these roads represent different aspects of your identity. So it'll be race to begin with. What we usually begin with is race, class, gender. And then we can move on to sexual identity or gender, sexual identity or sexual, oh my goodness, I've lost my words.
Sexual orientation
or sexual identity. Then we can move on to religion, to, you know, there's a lot of different aspects. So age, living with a handicap, there's different things that you can include into intersectionality. But basically, intersectionality helps us to look at the different aspects of one's identity and different types of oppression that one will deal with because of their identity that are happening at the same time. But it's also something that we've already, you know, been using. As LGBTQI people, we know that within our own broader community of LGBTQI people, mm-hmm. we have the L, which is the lesbians, and lesbians have a double discrimination because they're a woman and because they're also lesbians. Mm-hmm. So it's not exactly intersectionality, but it is something that can help you to understand intersectionality. Intersectionality started off as the work from black feminists, black African-American feminists. And, you know, the work has grown and it's finally come here with the help of different activists and jurists and different women.
How would you define decolonization?
So for me, in order to understand decolonization, we have to first look at the other terms that we were using before, mm-hmm. like inclusivity, like diversity. These are terms that we were using very much, but these are terms that have always been defined by white people. How can you define something that you are not?
Yeah.
How are you not asking the people who you see as diverse and you want to include, why are we not asking them to work at an actual working definition? So
that they are at the decision table.
So that they are at the decision table, so they actually have the power mm-hmm. to implement change. So it's not only being at the table, but also having the power to do something.
Yeah.
I've been seated at many tables where I did not have the power to do anything. No power to implement any change. And then I'm just a beautiful token.
Yeah.
That's all
so
it is.
So you mean like you were just sitting there, so the term inclusion could have been used,
definitely. So the term inclusion is used, but when I would, you know, state my ideas, when I would push for something, I would not be heard.
You are pushed aside.
I'm pushed to the side. I wasn't given any type of power. Mm-hmm. But also I believe that power is taken, not given. But sometimes you can't even do that. So give me the tools in order to empower myself.
Yes.
So that's basically, like, for me, decolonization, you first have to look at the other terms that we were using, why they aren't working, and then we can move forward to decolonization. And decolonization is basically understanding that we need to not look at everything through the eyes of colonization, through societal's norm, through what we would consider as the norm, mm-hmm. Because the norm defines everything. So basically what I want to do is remove the colonial or the neo-colonial view from everything. Not forgetting it. I don't want to whitewash it. I don't want to remove or forget that that happened. But I do want to make people understand that through decolonization, that we understand that the white way of looking at things is not the only way of looking at everything. That we need to understand that other people from the other side also have a way of seeing things, and their story needs to be told. Their story needs to be heard, and we need to actively listen to them.
if we really want to work towards this utopia of an inclusive, diverse community or society, then we need to actually look at the ugly sides of our society and admit that they're ugly. Admit that we need to do something and admit that we need to give the power, or that other people need to take the reins in order to implement that change.
Okay. Yeah. You heard her.
Okay.
And I think I had one more question. Do you think the actions from the summer Black Lives Matter movement, that it will have like a change that will stick?
That'll be long lasting,
yeah,
you
yeah,
mean?
Long lasting in society?
Well, that depends on white people. Like, Black Lives Matter has very much helped black people in coming together, in being together, in finding community, finding ways of healing, finding ways of strategizing, and finding ways of just empowering black people amongst us, amongst ourselves. That has been one of the beautiful things of Black Lives Matter. Now, if we want Black Lives Matter to actually continue on having the success it's had, that would mean that not only black people, but predominantly white people would understand that they have a very large role to play in the eradication of racism.
Okay.
Women didn't get the right to vote without the help of men. Even though we had a lot of suffragettes, we had the suffragette movement, we had a lot of women doing a lot of things on the ground, and we're very thankful to those women doing the work the work that they did, of course, but we didn't get that far without men just actually saying, oh, you know, maybe we should help them. We understand that they need to be autonomous. Unfortunately, we still live in the patriarchy, but you know, we didn't get to where we are today without the help of men. So why is it that white people can't understand that we need them to understand that they play an intricate role in racism, as it being a form of oppression that white people have created and they continuously uphold?
Yes.
If we want that to be gone, if we want to work towards this utopia, then white people need to acknowledge that there's an issue, admit that they have a problem, and commit to actually deconstructing the entire system, starting with themselves and with their family and with their friends, their colleagues, their nearest and dearest. They need to do that. But are they doing that? And they need to also understand that it's a lifelong commitment. Like, society will continuously contribute and basically pat you on the back if you just keep up the status quo. It's the easiest thing. Basically, you have to unlearn everything that society has been teaching you about, you know, what black people are, how to dehumanize them, that they're basically not the norm, so they're rejected on every single level. People just need to, you know, acknowledge this, and then we can move forward. You need to continuously educate yourself, continuously want to learn, and continuously actively listen. Actively listen, and not meet every single thing that you hear from a black person with confusion, doubt, friction, and sometimes violence. Like, that just needs to stop.
Okay. So you heard her. Educate yourself 24/7. And
listen to black people. Believe black people. Believe black women. Protect black women.
Well, thank you, Rachael, for this lovely meeting and interview.
And black femmes. Protect black femmes. Protect black everybody.
Okay. So let's have another drink.
Definitely. And,
thank you for the star.
My pleasure.
Ja, we gaan zo meteen overgaan naar het museumplein waar Bo staat en Yesha. En Bo die gaat haar beste set of the year geven. Kom maar mee. Ja, ik hoor de muziek al. komt goed. DJ Bo, Meng! Woo! And Yesha, of course! Yesha, I give the word to you.
Okay, hey everyone, we're back again here in Belgium, where the weather is still obviously unpredictable. It was shining earlier and now it's about to rain. I'm here with Bo Meng and we're gonna ask her a few questions. First question would be, we know that you're already an up-and-coming DJ, but what else do we need to know about Bo Meng?
Okay, if you allow me.
Yes.
You want me to introduce myself, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm really passionate about music.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also a queer artist.
Mm-hmm.
And what I can say is that I'm trying somehow to create the kind of atmosphere, the kind of parties that I would like to go to.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, they would be queer, but they will also be playing the kind of music I like.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's what I'm trying to show in the music that I play. And I've actually noticed that it's the same kind of people are attracted to the music that I play.
Yeah.
So that's how I was able to find some other DJs that also like the same kind of vibes that I do.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, for now, because it's an ever-changing process, for now that's what I'm doing.
That's really amazing. It's amazing how music can bond people together. It is truly the language of the soul.
Mm-hmm.
And my second question is, what can we expect on the coming days? What do you have to offer today and tomorrow and on the 22nd?
Okay, I don't know exactly in which order I'm gonna do it,
uh-huh.
but I'm gonna try and bring some different vibes. I'm gonna play some Afrobeat, of course, because that's the music that I'm the most familiar
mm-hmm.
to. I'm also gonna play some really chill vibes and a little bit of hip-hop, but I also wanna dive into Afro house and even house, a little bit of techno, like I'm trying to have a variation of
wow.
music, like, as much as I can.
Yeah, yeah, that's really something to look forward to. I'm excited to see you do your thing. And the last question is, where can we find your secret message?
My secret message, you can find it at my secret hotspot,
uh-huh.
which is Pipit Blues. It's a bookstore downtown. I really like it because like the owner is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It's a black-owned bookstore. It tends to focus on black authors and black books. It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all should check it out. Y'all should buy your books there. It's a really nice place. Very comfy, very cozy.
Thank you so much for your time, Bo. And we're looking forward to hearing your music. I, for one, am very excited. And that's not the music that we're looking forward to. But anyway, it was nice talking to you and I hope to meet you in one of your gigs. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen,
this is Bo Meng and this is Yesha Tolentino. See you.
See you soon, I hope. Bye.
Bye.
So, we hebben vandaag al een aantal ontmoetingen en toffe gesprekken gehad. Nu gaan we ook nog de Hula dansen, wat wel goed is, want het is inmiddels beginnen regenen. De tropische temperaturen zijn aanwezig. Jammer genoeg heeft mijn danspartner moeten afzeggen, dus ik ben een klein beetje nerveus. Maar ik denk dat dat goed komt met die toffe instructeur. We gaan net ietsje verder bij een queer collectief die ons de locatie geeft. En dan kunnen we straks allemaal samen de hula dansen. Aloha, tot straks! Oké, ik ben nu met de instructor van de hula aan de teksten. We gaan zo meteen met elkaar in verbinding gaan. Maar ik moet mij ook nog omkleden dat ik een beetje meer in de minute kom. En
I'm a hula teacher. It's been 12 years now that I doing that. I start when I was 15 years old, and I have a different hula class in French Polynesia. I have one class in USA, and then I have a new class in Brussels. I start last year. So it's like 124 students everywhere. And this is more than my passion, it's my life. So sharing my culture, sharing what I love, sharing Hawaiian spirit that we call Aloha spirit. And it's all about love, joy, happiness, a community, humility, and being together. And it's all about love. That's what hula is. Telling story, sharing love with people by the motion, by your expression, by the movement of your body and of your hips. So hula, it's telling a story through motion, through your fingers. When you do this, when we talk about water, the beauty of the water, the beauty of the flower, and the beauty of the place. It's all about express something through your motion.
Yeah, I like that.
What is important to know, in hula, there's many kind of hula. We have the traditional one that we express not the anger, but it's warrior, you know, it's only reserved at the beginning for men. Hula, it was a masculine man at the beginning of the story.
Just like tango, it was only men dancing together. Also pretty gay, probably.
Yeah, yes, exactly. Hula is also more than a dance, because you work on yourself. It's an inside exercise to express outside and then to share through the dance with the people. And it's all about.
Yes. And tell me, special kid, what is the meaning exactly of hula?
The meaning of hula just means move. Okay. It's a movement of the body. Okay. So when we say hula, it's just move. It's just the movement of the hips. That's what we call the hula. It's just the movement of, okay, of your body.
And aloha is like to say hi, but also bye.
Yes, exactly. That's the basic meaning of aloha. But aloha, it's more than say hi, it's more than say goodbye.
Okay.
Aloha is a way to connect people and recognize that the when you say aloha to someone, this person is important. You give life. So in aloha, we divide the words on two parts. Alo. So alo is the breath. It's that your emotion comes from inside, from here, you know, from your emotion. So when you alo, and then when you ha, you share life, you give life to the person in front of you. So aloha, it's giving life to someone.
Oh my God, this is so my philosophy. I'm gonna start doing hula every day.
Can you hear it? All right. Can you still hear my voice? Yes. Okay, perfect. Okay, so position is hands on the hips. Feet flat. Connection to the earth. Okay? Then we're going down. Keep the shoulders on the back. Nice posture.
close fingers on the hips. Then we're gonna do four step on the right and four step on the left. I'm go first, okay? It goes like this. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. So you start right and left. Good. Okay? Let's do it one more time. Hands on the hips. Go and one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three. One more time. And one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Good. That's the very basic step. Second, it's very easy. So you always dancing down. Okay, so you're going down. There you go. And then we point. Point back. 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 Okay, so this is the two basic steps that we have in Hawaiian dance. All right, hands on the hips. We're going down. Going down. Right hand. One, two, three, four, one, two.
Thank you. We keep in touch.
Okay.
Aloha.
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 So, for all you people watching, please try it at home with friends or on your own and show us how you did the hula. And we look forward to your best dance moves, and we hope to see you tomorrow again.
say of my mind is done.